One of the things I attribute to Rocketboom's success that a lot of people don't put much emphasis on is sort of understanding the dynamics of the IT and the interface design and keeping all of that up and running and smooth, because people expect everything to always be perfect, to be timely, and as soon as it goes wrong once, it's really easy to lose somebody. So having a solid background in that area has been really helpful, I think.
Welcome to Rocketboom Behind the Scenes.
Rocketboom is a 3 or 4 minute
or 5 minute
daily video blog.
Every day from Monday to Friday.
We are based in New York City and we...
It's hard to describe Rocketboom.
What is Rocketboom? I don't know, I still stumble on the same question.
It covers all kinds of things. It sort of covers the news.
Mostly appealing towards an internet audience.
Or it can be quirky and fun and abstract and nonsensical.
Yeah, it's just a little small glimpse of life.
That hopefully causes the person on the other end of it to just kind of go, oh, for a second.
Rocketboom.com, as mentioned in the New York Times, Wall Street Journal, NPR, Business Week, and other media, has been on the forefront of the video blog boom since its inception in 2004. Along with subsequent vlogs such as Lonely Girl 15, Z Frank, and Ask a Ninja, these online series have quickly made old media sit up and take notice. Founder Andrew Barron first got the idea for Rocketboom while working on John Edwards' 2004 presidential campaign.
I started to notice that video was working really well online, and I was able to sort of get a really good quality. And so when I looked around and noticed that nobody else was really doing it that way, I thought there was a big opportunity, so I just kind of seized the moment.
As Andrew often says, being first to market with an idea is a big advantage when working in a field as fast-paced as technology.
So we had that advantage already going for us. And then from that point on, it was just about persistence and trying to improve and continuously trying to get better and better.
So I need the assets for Kurt TV.
Okay, great. As soon as I get home, I'll send that over.
Initially, Andrew was not concerned about making money from Rocketboom, but rather building the brand.
The business model that we started off with was basically, it's so cheap and easy to do that we can just worry about doing the content and trying to get a large audience.
Because Rocketboom has not yet attempted to monetize its success, and because they've accepted only a few advertisers, they've had to be extremely frugal in their approach.
It requires producer, editor, and writer. Recently, for instance, it's been me writing and producing, Joanne, and then an editor.
And of course, that's the essence of why the video blog movement is so exciting for aspiring producers. The cost of entry is incredibly low. In addition, for those familiar with old media, it offers a sense of entrepreneurship and creativity free of focus groups, meddling executives, and bureaucratic red tape.
There's just something really spontaneous and fresh about being able to do that. And I've worked in television where sometimes you're part of a really big production company. We'd be driven in the morning in our black car, and you'd go into makeup and you'd have your dressing room, and it was so over the top. And so of course, if you woke up that morning thinking, wow, I've had a really good idea for the show, it might come to fruition sort of 6 months later after your producer has battered it into a completely different shape from your initial idea.
In many ways, bandwidth is the lifeblood of an online show, and for startup productions, budgeting and responding to these ever-changing needs can be expensive and challenging.
In the very beginning, when Rocketboom first started going, we went through this little stage of incidents where we would upgrade the servers, and then they, like a month or something later, that it would crash again, or it would get clogged up, or the performance wasn't great.
Video bloggers have special needs in that they have to be concerned with both the ability to handle traffic and the ability to push the video out quickly.
Like a lot of people, even if they can handle the traffic to their website, they have a very small pipe And so it just takes forever for them to actually, you know, send the video out or something. So I always have been on top of making sure that we pay the extra to push it out fast. We're on like the fattest pipe, you know, coming in from the Atlantic Ocean right now. And we get also a really exceptional deal. It's kind of interesting, but when you're a website and you get beyond this threshold of having so much traffic that you become a valuable promotional tool for the server, by us just consequently directing a lot of traffic, then you know that makes for a better incentive.
In terms of software, Rocketboom uses a variety of off-the-shelf products to run the website.
Rocketboom uses lots of different applications to try to help build the audience. We're just integrating Plig, which is sort of a dig type of a content management system. We've got a wiki, which is really nice because people can go up and just add stuff, and then it's also easy for us to just throw stuff up and then people can fix it up. We also have a voice to text video search, so that means that all of the audio and everything that, you know, was not in a transcript anywhere can be searched out and people can find that.
By skillfully employing and integrating all this software, Rocketboom has created an interactive community setting where the audience plays a significant role in helping to program the content.
I'd say about 25 to 30% of all of the content that we discuss on the show actually comes from the audience.
An audience that, thanks to both the reach of the internet and to translation software, is not limited to the English-speaking world.
Just today, I think I saw comments and emails and interest in Rocketboom from Singapore, Australia, New Zealand, France, China with mention of South Korea, and Germany. And I mean, I could go on, the list is really endless. And what I love about Rocketboom too is that we have correspondents spread around different parts of the world who contribute to our content. And again, it's that idea that you can upload a video file onto your computer in South Africa and we get it here seconds later, or however long it takes if there are compression issues, and it just breaks down barriers. A company called DotSub came to us recently and they've developed software to simultaneously translate video content on the internet. And so we work with them now and we've had wonderful results from people in countries where they don't necessarily understand everything we say, or they want to just feel that it's more personalized, or they speak English and their native tongue, or their native tongue and English, and want to jump on and help to translate an episode for their countrymen, their fellow countrymen. And so there's just a really nice international community.
As stated earlier, Andrew's focus to date has been on building the brand, but at some point he hopes to capitalize on that growth. And in order to do that, he needs to be able to track the size of his audience, which he currently estimates at about 300,000 per day. However, tracking an audience is no easy task in the internet age.
Well, there's kind of three types of audience. There's people who come to visit the website. There's people who come and just grab the video files right off of our server without going to the website, like through RSS. And then there's people who watch it on another distribution partner, or like on another distribution platform.
This poses several problems. First, unlike normal websites, Andrew's not concerned with page hits, but rather full video downloads.
Not how many people are out there watching it, but how many videos are being watched each day.
And these are not as easy to track. Two, he can't obtain all of the information himself and often has to rely on third-party partners for part of the numbers.
At some point we kind of lose track of it, but for the most part it's just a matter of going out and accumulating all those numbers.
Three, many of the popular tracking programs like Google Trends and Alexa have hidden biases. For example, they don't have the ability to detect RSS traffic, as well as results from a wide variety of web browsers that currently exist. So what might work for one website might not be accurate for another. And fourth, the better a site gets at distributing its programs, the more complicated all this gets. Ultimately, what's needed is an industry standard approach that measures the wide variety of sources in a consistent, accurate methodology. As one of the industry pioneers, Andrew has been very influential and helpful in encouraging others to start their own video blogs. Despite the long hours and many challenges in this growing industry, he takes great joy in the fact that his actions may inspire others to do the same.
Well, I think the most, across the board, the most special thing is hearing from people who watched Rocketboom and it inspired them to come up with an idea. Like, even if they thought, this sucks, you know, that it gives them an idea like, hey, I think the thing that everybody thinks first is like, hey, I could do that. And that's all, you know, and that's all that's required. And then they can take that thought and then run with it.
It sort of encourages people to be their own producer, writer, artist, journalist.
Just to think that it's inspiring other people, I think, has been kind of probably the most special